She's here to help us find hope in our pain and explain the practice of lament. She's also the author of A Louder Song. Welcome, Aubrey Sampson.
Hi, Melinda. Thanks so much for having me.
I know it's been pretty emotional. So thanks for your grace and understanding as we came out of that panel. But I know that you have experienced personal grief, mm-hmm. so you get what we just saw in the panel.
Yeah. 2015 for me. So we're about actually 5 years now, because it was in October. My husband and I opened the doors to our church plant, a little church in the Chicagoland area. And the same week, my first book, a book called Overcomer, came out. And also that same week, I woke up inexplicably just unable to walk.
Wow.
I couldn't get out of bed, could put no pressure on my legs whatsoever. My husband was actually carrying me around the house. I was eventually hospitalized and diagnosed with a disease that impacts my joints. Now, praise God, I'm doing well now, but that was a dark, dark season of grief. On top of that, we were in the middle already of grieving my cousin Cameron, who was like a brother to me, like an uncle to my kids. He was snowshoe hiking in Crater Lake National Park, Oregon. He stepped out onto a snow cornice, and then Cameron plummeted to his death.
Oh.
Years later, park rangers still haven't found his body. And then on top of that, our youngest son had to have spinal cord surgery and receive years of care. And so it was just as your amazing panel has just talked about, it was a year of great difficulty. The reason I wrote The Louder Song is because the Lord met me there and invited me into the spiritual discipline and the spiritual language of lament, which eventually God met me and moved me back to a place of hope.
Aubrey, wow. I want to understand lament, because it's like grief and lament go hand in hand. I think that will help us as we end the show on how important that is as we grieve to lament. So what is it? Why is it important? And how has it helped you?
Such a great question, Melinda. Lament is known biblically as an impolite plea, which is kind of a funny phrase, but it really is an expression of grief and agony and sorrow and kind of all the ugly stuff, but to God. You're not just expressing that pain to avoid or to yourself. You're actually giving it to God as a prayer. Laments are often in scripture. Actually, laments are in scripture more than praise songs are in scripture, which a lot of people don't realize. But the beautiful thing about lament is, I think in our relationships with God, we often think, you know, we can only bring him our praises and our worship. Mm-hmm. And of course he is worthy of those things. But in our grief and in our sorrow, God has given us this language with which we can come to him openly and express the hardest things we've ever been through. He's given us the language. He permits us to use it. And then God is with us in that. Mm-hmm. And so lament really is an invitation from God, not to run from him, not to carry it alone, but to say, okay, God, evil is evil. I mean, this stuff that I am dealing with, or this stuff that my people are dealing with, is some of the worst thing that I've ever seen in my life. And yet I know that you are making all things new. I know that you say you are here with me. And so lament helps us hold both of those things at once, and really just invite God into the process and watch him show up. And he does, believe it or not, he does.
Aubrey, it sounds like more than ever, we need lament in this season. So practically, what does that look like? So we have had loss of life and jobs and freedoms and security and control and loss, and we're grieving. How do we practically lament and find hope in that place?
Yeah. We have certainly globally experienced a season of grief, haven't we? I think there are a few ways that we can lament. I'll talk individually and then communally briefly. But individually, you know, every lament in scripture follows a pattern. Every lament begins with the word how, then moves to yet, and then moves to with, God's withness with us in our difficulty. And so like David begins his laments, how long, O Lord? How long must you hide your face from me? How long until you show up and make a difference? And so honestly, one thing we can do is grab a journal or grab our phone, grab something and begin to write our hows down. God, how are you going to make this better? God, how are you going to show up? How are you going to show your goodness in this? And then we can offer those hows as a prayer to God and honestly, just leave them at his feet and wait for him to show up in them. Laments then move to a place of yet. There's a really famous yet in Lamentations 3:21. You know, Jeremiah is lamenting, I remember my bitterness. I remember the gall. I have affliction all around me. And yet this I call to mind. And therefore I have hope. The great, great love of the Lord never ends. Because of his love, I am not consumed. Yeah. And so the yet in our lament is not something we can force necessarily, especially we're in those deep seasons of grief, but it is something that we can begin to say, okay, Spirit of God, help me move to a place of yet. Help me declare my yet. Help me to remember that even if I can't see the other side of this, you are good. And so I will declare that yet of faith in the ground because I know you're going to show up. And then the last part of lament is God's witness and just asking God to show up with his presence. Because we don't always get answers. We don't always get solutions. Some evil and pain is simply unreasonable. And so there aren't reasons for it. But what we have is God's power. What we have is God's presence. What we have is God's comfort. And so in our lament, we can just say, okay, God, I need you to show up. And then wait in the unanswerable and he will show up.
I am so encouraged by that, Aubrey. I think that permission that you are giving us to say how and with and yet and call out to God, that is so encouraging. It feels like sort of like a weight has been taken off of us to say, it's okay. God's not afraid of our grief and anger, but he is with us and loves us and cares about us enough to help us through this time of grief. I thank you so much for your thoughts. I thank you for your book. And I'm encouraged by you. Keep doing the great work that you're doing.
Thanks so much for having me, Melinda. Thanks for letting me talk.
Thanks.